mountain, you called Moses and Elijah to witness to you, and you confirm the faith of your disciples. Accept our prayers and the fragrance of our incense. Grant us joy and happiness with you in the light of your eternal kingdom. For we will continuously praise and glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
It has been risen and taken away. To this day, in fact, whenever Moses is read, the veil lies over their hearts. But whenever a person turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Praise be to God always.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Lord, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, Moses, and one for Elijah.
Which is so divided down the middle.
But the question needs to be presented because the Catholics statistically are just as divided among themselves as the rest of the population. So how is it possible that a single body of people who are all baptized in the Lord have such different fundamental ideas as to their existence so that they themselves be divided against themselves? This is bizarre. The notion of the kingdom of God, what our Lord is speaking about today, this kingdom or the reign of God, Malkutho in the Syrian, this governance of God in the world is what is central to this manifestation of the Trinity and the Transfiguration. But we come back to the question, what principles do we live by? Do we just simply form our minds and our ideas according to the newspapers, the media, and everything else that we just read and see on television? Or rather, the kingdom of God is meant to be this dominion and this governance of God, which is the grace within us that forms and illuminates the mind. The kingdom of God in its essence is this governance of God, which is present within the world from the beginning of creation. It is something which in the beginning is hidden. It is part of what we can know from the moment of creation. And it is something, as the Syriac fathers say, it's part of the revelation of God. But it's only foreshadow. From Mount Sinai and Moses, the kingdom of God becomes now prophetic. It is something which is announced to come. So it's better than just simply nature. But it's announcing this governance. And so there's always the principle of God's governance and God's ideas which run throughout the world. But now from Mount Sinai, Moses become clearly announced. But they are also only foreshadowings, now prophetic, announced then by the prophets and by Moses. When we come to the incarnation, the Word of God, the Son of God enters into the world, we now have the Hidden One who reveals Himself in His Divine Son in the incarnation. This is the beginning of the kingdom. And this is the reason why the Gospels tell us that from the time of the preaching of John the Baptist was the beginning of the kingdom of God. Now it is no longer just foreshadowed. Now it is not just simply types of the prophets, but it is now something which clearly becomes manifest, inaugurated in our Lord's incarnation. And it is something which remains present, conscious, knowable within mystery of that which we call the church until the day of judgment. And on the day of judgment, the kingdom of God will be in its full consummation of glory on that last day. So the kingdom of God, this reign of God, this dominion of God is something which runs throughout all of history from the very beginning. And it is the meaning of the principle of the ideas that are given to us in our baptism and by grace. It is why until the 20th century, the Catholic populations pretty much fought together on the same ideas. Because the principles in their minds and the concepts in their minds were the same. The fact that the Catholic population is so divided these days makes us have to pose the question of really, how Catholic are we? How well do we know this faith? How well do we know the kingdom of God? So what is taking place in the Transfiguration, and to put it into context, our Lord in chapter 8 of St. Mark has just announced his passion. And this has caused a great shock to the apostles, that I am going to be betrayed in Jerusalem. But then he immediately tells them after, which adds to the shock, that you yourselves must carry your cross behind me. This is a double shock. It's one thing to be told that the one that you love is going to be betrayed and put to death. It's another thing when he then says, and you're going to have to follow me. So we're told that after 6 days, so this comes on the seventh day, which to all of the people of Israel would always remind them of that initial creation of the seventh day, the Sabbath, and the day of rest at the end of the first creation. And our Lord takes Peter, James, and John, these three men, and these three men are chosen out of the 12. Peter, we understand his significance. He is chief among them. He has leadership. But sometimes we forget about the significance of James and his brother John. James is the first of the apostles to be martyred for the gospel. James is the first one to be put to death because of the preaching of the kingdom. And John is going to be required, his significance is that he is going to be required to live a very, very long life, probably close to 100. He lives essentially the entire first century. They try to kill him several times, they exile him, and he winds up dying in Ephesus. So these three men are brought. These are the same three men who are going to witness his passion and his sweat of blood in Gethsemane in a short time. So what our Lord is doing between this juncture of announcing his passion and this shock, and that you're going to have to follow me if you're my disciples, he's taking three of these men to fortify them, to strengthen them, to encourage them, to establish them, as they continue this work, the preaching of the kingdom. Now in the context, what is also taking place here just after, in this chapter of St. Mark, is when our Lord descends from the mountain, he finds a father and son. I encourage you to go online and Google, if you don't have a copy in your house, the painting of Raphael of the Transfiguration. It's very famous, you'll find it, don't worry. The original hangs in the Vatican. And you have the famous vision of the Transfiguration with our Lord framed with Moses and Elias. But at the bottom of the mountain, Raphael has added another image and another story that's going on to give you this full chapter of St. Mark. It's not what you usually see when they represent the picture. So if you Google and find Raphael's Transfiguration, and you only see light and three men and three apostles, you don't have the whole painting. The whole painting includes this father and the son, because the son is possessed. And the young boy, the young man, has his eyes rolled back in his head in convulsions at this demonic possession. This is what happens immediately after the Transfiguration. Our Lord comes down from the mountain, finds this family, and winds up freeing this boy, reminding everyone that the demonic is only cast out by prayer and fasting. So the Transfiguration today, for us to bring this all together now, what our Lord does when he brings them up, and Mount Tabor is considered the place where this took place. There is a Catholic church on top of Mount Tabor, of the Transfiguration, of course, and it's one of the most exquisite architectural successes, in my opinion. Because what the architect has done is, when you walk into the church, there is a stairs that goes down underneath the main altar. And there is what we call the crypt chapel underneath. This is a chapel below. But it means the central open part, there are two staircases that run up the sides to the sanctuary, which is very elevated. And above this is this magnificent mosaic of the Transfiguration, of our Lord in glory, with Moses and Elias. So that when you're in the church, you're positively required to look up to follow the Mass, in order to see on this transcendent Mount Tabor. So our Lord brings them up to the top of the mountain, and there before him, of course, as we have in the description, he is transfigured into this luminosity, this radiation of light and transparency and glory. And then we're told that Moses and Elias appear with him. In the Gospel of St. Mark, we're told they're only conversing. But in the parallel gospel, we're told talk to our Lord about his death, that he's going to suffer in Jerusalem. So this is all connected, the transfiguration, his betrayal on Calvary, and the fact that every disciple must pick up his cross also and follow him. And of course, then we have the wonderful response of Peter. Lord, if it were the 21st century, he would say, Lord, this is awesome. Let us make three tents. We'll throw them up here. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, because then we can just keep looking at this beauty. How pretty. Love this. Because everyone loves the nice part of religion, which is why in a few months' time this church will be filled, because it is Christmas. It is easy to find people who want the nice parts of religion, the nice interior feelings, the nifs of the life. And we like it, it's nice, we like the little baby, we like the little things, but our Lord did not teach that. Our Lord said, I am going to be betrayed, and you yourselves are going to have to carry your cross behind me. This lesson is incredibly clear. But Peter gives that very human response. Let's keep this beautiful thing. Why can't it always be Christmas? If religion were always Christmas, or religion were always I got something like palms or ashes, I'd always be there. But I don't get stuff when I go, so I don't like it. As if receiving our Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity on a daily basis is nothing. In these people's minds, ashes and little statues of babies outrank the divine, substantial presence of God incarnate. This is perverse. We go back to the original question. What are the principles? What are the concepts by which our minds as Christians are formed? So Peter's out of himself. He doesn't know. And we're told that immediately by St. Mark. He doesn't know what he's saying. They were so overcome by fear. They're in awe. And they fall down in a parallel text. They fall down on their faces. And then our Lord touches them. And when they look up, there's nobody here anymore. It's just Jesus. Now, for the people who like nifs, that's not enough. And when they get to the bottom of the mountain, those people would walk away. But to the Christian disciples, they understand that the man who is just transfigured in front of us is the same man who stands in front of me now. Moses and Elias are speaking to our Lord in the Transfiguration because they are giving testimony that this is now the fulfillment of everything for which creation, the law of Mount Sinai, was created. This man and his death and his resurrection in Jerusalem. Which means that the Old Testament is just that, old. It is terminated, which is why we have the epistle readings of today's Mass, which we'll do next year. This revelation of God incarnate is showing us the perfect act of divine charity, which is going to be accomplished and consummated in death and the fullness of giving. So to finish with the last 2 points, what is this doing for us individually? We're not Peter, we weren't standing there. And it has to do with our vision of what human nature is and our vision of what divine grace is. Because this kingdom of God that we talk about, that has been here from the beginning, which is always present for those who have ears to hear, as our Lord says, is ultimately a revelation of the person of God, who God is. And everything that God is, he gives to the divine word. Everything that he has, everything that he is given in this generation of what we call Son. And of this love of the Father and the Son who give substantially in this divine love of the one eternal God, they breathe forth spirare, respiration, spiritus. They breathe forth the divine law of eternity within them, so that everything that they have and everything that they are is the Spirit inspiration. So that what it means fundamentally is that what God reveals Himself to be in His person is substantial, eternal selflessness. Everything that the Father has, He gives to His Son. Everything that the Son has is from the Father. Everything that God is and has, He breathes forth in the divine love of the Spirit. And to the degree that we ourselves listen and enter into this kingdom, or as the anaphora of St. John Chrysostom says, that the kingdom dwell within us and transform us, we become more and more selfless, godlike. And to the degree that we do not become selfless, we stand in judgment and risk of damnation. Because it separates us further and further and further from God who reveals Himself. So the last two points are in this revelation of the Transfiguration. Our Lord is both God and man. He is also revealing what humanity and its nobility was originally meant to be. And lastly, He's reminding of us of the transcendent beauty of grace and what grace can transform within our lives. So then in the end, what are the principles that govern us in our Catholic faith? It does mean concretely a knowledge of the Catechism, of course. But it is all built upon the structure of a vision of selflessness, of transcendent beauty of grace, and the nobility even of nature that God originally intended. This is what we have to create our personal lives on. This is what we have to create our family lives and our society, societal life upon. When we do this, we begin to enter into the kingdom. The kingdom begins to enter into us. And as the voice from the cloud says, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to Him." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Itemot madeve dalomo, valo dalomo da hode tango, venium suho taimo tohe ule baitoches ule paieto, ot gusho.
To the Son, to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
May we who have remained in your divine love be made worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with a holy kiss. May we always speak words of peace, think of peace, and work for peace. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we raise glory to you and to your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of the Holy Spirit.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Thank you.
on the bright cloud. He took the form of a slave, yet truly he is the Son of your Majesty. He willingly became man to make us divine. He was born from a woman's womb, that we may be born again from a spiritual womb. He became our brother, so that through his grace we may become your children and heirs. He took us from being slaves and made us your children. He promised us a share in the reward that allows us to call you Abba, Father. He cleansed us from our sins with his precious blood that he poured out for us. For he is your only Son. Kiri eleison. Wab yamo hadam tom harsho di lema ben paye. Et zame lachmo vino koli shoto.
Mercy upon us.
In your compassion you have made us worthy of the gift of your forgiving body and blood. So make us worthy to be one with you in holiness as you are one with your Father. For this your church implores you and through you and with you implores your Father, saying, receive your graces, we thank you for them, and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, O God, have mercy on us, and hear us.
Descend and rest upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Salt
every place throughout the world. committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will. That in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, and give His honor and heaven and honor, to Him be glory.
again, we thank you, O Lord, and raise glory to you, giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O Lord of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us,
O
Lord.
Lord Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these your gifts and graces and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies and your blood with our souls, for the pardon of faults, the forgiveness of sins, and eternal life. You are blessed and your kingdom is holy. We raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
O God the Father, we bow before you and entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your mercy, to rest your right hand full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by the cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and the blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.